Bonsoir. When I made episode 4 of this Building a Compiler series, I intentionally left out some optimizations because they were rather complicated. In this episode we shall do them. But first, one optimization that should have been in the previous episode, but I totally forgot about it. Here is an example function that simply returns one of two variables depending whether two other variables match. The compiler generated an equals test, a branch, and two return statements. But here's what happens if we change the condition into a mismatch. Now there's a whole lot more things happening without a reason, but it is easy to fix. If an ifnc instruction is applied on a register that contains the result of an ik instruction, and one of the sources to the ik instruction is a register that contains a literal zero, and the source that the ik instruction samples is still accessible at the point of the ifnc, replace the source of the ifnc with the source of the ik instruction and swap the next and cont pointers. Now, as we get closer to actual machine code, it will make sense to make some changes to our intermediate representation. As you remember, I designed this intermediate representation so that whenever you want to utilize number literals in your code, you need to create a separate init statement for it. Having a simple intermediate representation is great for optimizations, because there aren't that many special cases to worry about, but for code generation, it makes things a bit difficult. I decided to address this issue with a small patch. Basically, a certain number of register parameters is reserved to indicate literal parameters. Those numbers act as indices into a global array that stores all the distinct literal parameters. Because this is a project for a YouTube video under the guise of a real motive and not a perfectly designed compiler to be used by generations to come, I'm just going to copy-paste the getLiteral method from the previous episode and make small changes to it. This time we are not only interested in number literals, but also of references to globals, such as strings or functions. Essentially all detected pairs of identifier plus number will be added to the number constants array and replaced with a special register number that is an index to that array. Then all statements in the whole program are checked. If any of them has a read parameter that is known at compile time to have a certain value in the register, that register is replaced with a reference to the number constants array. As a special optimization, init statements immediately followed by ret statements will be subject to that same treatment, even if the ret statement can be reached from multiple different contexts and could otherwise not be optimized. And this is what we have accomplished so far. Now the next topic will be register allocation. I have a book called Advanced Compiler Design and Implementation by Steven Muchnick. It is impressively detailed, covering nearly everything you can think of concerning advanced compiler design and implementation. If you are interested of purchasing the book, there is a link in the video description to an Amazon page where you can buy it. But right now I am interested about register allocation. Page 481. Let's see what the book has to say about that topic. It's here, and it's not a small topic. The book begins describing a graph coloring algorithm in much detail with many code samples. Then it describes an interference graph, and so on, and so on, and so on. There is a slight problem for me. These algorithms assume that the compiler operates on a single static assignment. My compiler does not. Of course, the book also has a huge chapter about single static assignment SSA, but so far I haven't done anything in this compiler by the book, and I am not going to start now. I'm going to make stuff up by myself. Kids don't do this at home. Or do, because it's so much more exciting. With the next episode in mind, the basic idea in my compiler will be this. IR registers R0, R1, R2 and so on will be directly converted into the platform's CPU registers up to the number of registers available. Any IR register with a number greater than the number of actual hardware registers will be replaced with a memory variable, likely from the stack. We should at least try to perform calculations using as small a register number as possible. In this example code, the register numbers are definitely not optimal. I spy things like R10, R17 and R18, which are totally unnecessary considering that, for example, R5 is not even used. The basic idea of my register renaming algorithm is this. We go through all statements that write into a register, but in a certain order. The statements with the shortest lifetime on the result will be processed first. For each register that is written to by that statement, we check the current knowledge of all registers with a smaller number than that register. If there exists another register with a smaller number that either does not contain anything meaningful or that contains a value that is never read by any statement that can still be reached from this point, the right register of this statement will be replaced with a smaller register number, and all statements that were reading this register number will be changed to read the new register number instead. However, this change can only be done if the statements that depend on this write instruction do not get the contents of that same register alternatively from some other write instruction. It is almost as complicated as the copy optimization from the end of the last episode, and checking all these conditions requires a lot of work. Commence music. Now, when we compare the optimization of these two functions, before and after the register allocator, a clear change emerges. The new shape of the length function only uses 3 registers, whereas the previous one used 4, and the highest register number used is R2. For the STPCPYN function, the number of registers used has changed from 8 to 5, 3 of which were parameters. However, it could still be better. Notice here how it makes a copy of the variable. The only place that R4 is used is here. What if the code was written like this instead? Then R4 would not be needed. The other copy could also be removed. This is actually really tricky to get right. When you shuffle code around, changing the relative order of statements, you have to be really careful to make sure that the behavior of the code does not change. A compiler must never ever change what the code does when it optimizes the code, provided the code is well formed. If your source code contains undefined behavior, then the compiler is free to make demons fly out of your nose, for all that matters. So ensuring that the code is still well formed after the optimization is paramount. But there is another point to consider. When I released the previous episode, I was asked this question. When the compiler runs different optimization methods in a loop, is it possible that it gets stuck in an infinite loop where it first changes the code one way, then it changes the code some other way, and then it changes back and so on, constantly alternating between two or more different shapes for the code? This is an important question. Yes, if you are not careful with the optimization algorithms, it is very much possible that the compiler may get stuck in an infinite loop. The way you prevent this problem is by defining clearly what constitutes an improvement. Define unambiguously how the two code snippets are put in a better-worse order and why, and make sure all these definitions interact in a purposeful manner. This can be tricky sometimes. This very optimization method, where I change the order of statements, is precariously prone to getting stuck in an infinite loop. The 10-line if statement is carefully crafted to prevent an infinite loop from occurring. There is a lot more that could be done by reorganizing the code. Examples are listed on the screen, but I could not think of a clever way to write them. In any case, let's see how it runs now. It is certainly more optimal now. But there is another thing that it is now. Buggy. I said earlier that the compiler must never change how the code behaves, and here it has certainly changed it. The code was supposed to read and write using the values of the pointer before the increment, but that's not what is happening in the modified code. It is first incrementing the pointer, and then using that incremented value in the read and the write. Furthermore, it is actually overwriting the pointer with the read statement. This is totally broken! What did I do wrong? Off-screen, I traced the problem to the code that I wrote in the last episode. I did say,
"Unfortunately, there are myriad ways that this can go wrong,"
in the last episode. And despite my best efforts, there is still one situation where the copy optimization is invalid. In this case, I found it easier to check whether a mistake has already happened rather than to check against it in advance and cancel the changes if there was a mistake. My compiler is definitely not breaking any speed records with this kind of coding. Okay, it's not buggy anymore. Somehow it's not quite as optimal as I hoped. In fact, we are back at using 5 registers. But to quote Captain Picard, it is possible to commit no mistakes and still lose. That is not a weakness. That is life. By the way, there is a certain thing about this optimizer that I don't think I made clear enough yet. Many programmers are shy of using Boolean status variables. In the fear of adding lots of extra comparisons to their program, they add things like goto and break statements in hopes of better efficiency. Here are 3 example functions. Each of them uses a Boolean variable to indicate loop termination. My compiler is made on a shoestring budget, but even it is smart enough to optimize away these condition variables. Look at the IR code. You can't find the Boolean variables anywhere. They are completely translated into program logic. If my shabby compiler that I only made for a YouTube video can do this, then how much more likely is a professional production quality compiler able to optimize away these status variables? Food for thought. In the next and final episode of this series, we will finally go into the process of generating actual machine code for at least 2 different platforms. Hope to see you then!
Merci d'avoir regardé. À la prochaine!